Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Let us pray. Father God, creator of our life, how can we find words to thank you, praise and worship you as we celebrate the wonder of Easter? For it is on the crucifixion, death, and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, all our hope is founded. It is the core of our Christian faith, of all that we believe. In it we find forgiveness for sins when we come confessing them in true penitence before you, Abba Daddy God. It is the shed blood of our crucified Savior that washes away our sins and makes us whiter than snow. It is in His death and burial we can die to self and let self be buried in the grave. It is through His glorious resurrection that we too can experience the new, abundant, victorious life He offers to each one of us here on earth, even as we wait to experience it in all its unimaginable fullness in eternity with you, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. How indeed can we say thanks? Yet we know you welcome us into your presence as we offer our hearts to you in return for your boundless, extravagant love for us. You remind us that we are the apple of your eye. May this Easter burst forth with the resurrection power of our Lord in us, so we go and tell others to share the good news of this new life, its love, joy and hope and peace that is in it for all mankind. Thank you, Daddy God. We love you, we worship you, and we adore you. Amen.
Thank you. gospel readings come to us from St. Matthew chapter 27, reading verse 62 to 66, and St. Luke chapter 24, reading verse 1 to verse 10. On the next day which followed the day of preparation, the chief priests and Pharisees gathered together to Pilate, saying, "Sir, we remember while he was still alive, how that deceiver said, 'After 3 days I will rise.' Therefore, command that the tomb be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples come by night and steal him away, and say to the people, 'He has risen from the dead.' So the last deception will be worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard. Go your way and make it as secure as you can." So they went and made the tomb secure, sealing the stone and setting the guard. He is risen. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened, as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then, as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again.' And they remembered his word. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles." This is the gospel of Christ. Praise be to Christ our Lord.
Alleluia.
Brothers and sisters, I speak to you in other name than the name of our wonderful resurrected Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. May the words I speak go forth with such an anointing of Holy Spirit that they will touch and minister to every heart of every listener here this evening. In Jesus' precious name I pray. Amen. Lest we forget. In the 3 years of Jesus' ministry here on earth, he had quite a following of people wherever he went. Apart from his 12 disciples and the women who were a permanent part of his close group, all other kinds of people followed him. The curious, the critics, the hungry, the poor, the sick, the lame, the outcast, the ones who hated and despised him. This last group consisted mainly of the religious set, the chief priests and Pharisees, Sadducees and scribes. They had set themselves up as Jesus' enemies. They did not like the words he preached. They did not like his association with the outcasts and sinners. This Jesus broke their Sabbath laws and did the unthinkable by alluding to himself as the Messiah that the Bible prophets had declared would come. This religious group took careful note of everything that Jesus said and carefully stored it in their memory. After they succeeded in their dastardly plot to get Jesus crucified, they approached Pilate with another demand, as recorded in Matthew 27, beginning at verse 63. They said to Pilate, "We remember that this imposter, meaning Jesus, claimed that he would rise from the dead after 3 days. So please order the tomb to be sealed until after the third day. Seal it so that his disciples can't come and steal the corpse and tell people he rose from the dead. Then the last deception would be worse than the first." And Pilate replied, "I will send soldiers to guard the tomb. Go with them and make the tomb as secure as possible." So they left and sealed the stone, and Pilate's soldiers secured the tomb. Here we see the enemies of Jesus having memorized the words spoken by Jesus to convince Pilate to do their bidding. At last, they would be totally rid of this Jesus menace. So they thought. Brothers and sisters, my first point for tonight is that we, the followers of Jesus, are also surrounded by enemies, Satan's demonic imps, who carefully note what we say in order to use negative words we say over ourselves, family, and other loved ones to prevent us from experiencing the wonder of the new resurrected life Jesus offers us through his victory over death, hell, and the grave. The enemies of our Lord did not realize that a stone, no matter how huge, that the soldiers and the seal of the mighty Roman Empire were no match for the resurrection power of our all-powerful God. Now, on the other hand, let us take a look at Jesus' 11 disciples and the women who were with him from the beginning of his ministry. They too had heard Jesus predict his crucifixion, death, and resurrection on several occasions, as recorded in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, where each gospel records it 3 times. In Matthew 16:21, it reads like this: "From then on, Jesus began to clearly reveal to his disciples that he was destined to go to Jerusalem and suffer injustice from the elders, the leading priests, and religious scholars. He also explained that he would be killed and 3 days later be raised to life again. But unlike the enemies of Jesus, these followers who so dearly loved Jesus had completely forgotten these words. Their reaction to Jesus' crucifixion and death, the way it impacted their lives, show us clearly that none of them had any connection of this very important statement Jesus had made repeatedly. Should not all of them have been at the tomb early that Sunday morning, bubbling over with uncontained excitement? Should not they have had a joyous feast of celebration awaiting their resurrected Lord? They had forgotten, every one of them. But even as we take a look now at how forgetting what Jesus said impacted their lives in all that transpired, let us too keep an eye on ourselves and see if we do not at the same time find ourselves in the same position as the disciples. What we can learn from these post-resurrection occurrences can help us now, even now, 2,000 years later. Let's look at the grieving, heartbroken women. They had spent hours after the crucifixion preparing their herbs and oils and perfumes to take on an early Sunday morning mission. They were going to the tomb to further embalm the body of Jesus, to keep it preserved in death. Having forgotten Jesus' promise that he would rise again on that morning, all their focus is on preservation of death. Is this true for us too? Preserving dead situations in our lives? In spite of their best motive, it was a totally wrong mission on which the women were embarking. Resurrection is not about preserving the dead situations in life. It is about new life in a dead situation. It took the empty tomb, the angelic messengers, to jolt their memory of Jesus' predictions that he would rise on the third day. Are we in a similar situation? Do our memories need a jolt? What about the disciples who had run away? Where were they after the crucifixion of Christ? How had it impacted them? Having forgotten Jesus' predictions about his resurrection, they are hiding behind locked doors. They are fearful, utterly confused, disoriented. They don't know what to think, how to deal with this situation. They are in shock. Their world, all their dreams and hopes had come crashing down. Can we identify with such a range of emotions when adverse situations occur in our lives? The Jesus of mighty miracles, and for whom they had left all and followed for 3 years, was dead at the hands of the Roman soldiers. In that state, they were unable to process the good news that the women came to tell them. They could not believe the good news that Jesus had indeed risen. Having forgotten Jesus' words, instead of rejoicing, they were plunged into a dead situation of doubt, fear, unbelief, deep foreboding, utter confusion, which prevented them from seeing the truth of the resurrection. They called the women's report about the angels and the empty tomb idle tales. Are there situations in our lives which cause us to see God's truth as idle tales when his messengers speak to us of the new resurrection life we can have in him? The two disciples on the road to Emmaus. Later on that Easter Sunday, two disciples left the group to walk 8 miles to Emmaus. What prompted that decision? We can only speculate. Maybe they thought the situation was completely hopeless, that all was lost, and were returning to all they had left behind in following Christ, to the way of life they lived before. For us, that might be addictions, abuse, worldliness, and such other things that we have left behind. Maybe they were returning to their home to find solace there. Maybe, maybe. What we do know is that with gloom and doom, they kept rehashing Jesus' crucifixion, death, and burial as they kept embalming him in their minds. We too are embalming Jesus if all we can talk about is the doom and gloom in relation to our situations in our lives. And like these two men, we fail to recognize Jesus as he comes and walks side by side, step by step, and talks with us and clarifies our missed understandings, even as we are going in the wrong direction, backwards. If only the disciples who were so close to Jesus had understood his predictions about himself, if only they had focused more closely on what he had said, if only they were not so wrapped up in their own expectations of him as a deliverer whose mission was to free them from the Roman rule and domination. If only they had caught the vision of his true identity and his true destiny as the divine savior of the world. If only they had truly listened to Jesus' heart of love that nailed him to the cross as the sacrificial lamb, making atonement for the sin of all mankind. If only they had understood the magnitude of his glorious resurrection power and its total defeat of death, hell, the grave, and all the powers of darkness. If only they had remembered, how so much different their lives would have been. If only we could remember. Yes, brothers and sisters, if only we too can remember this resurrection victory in times of life's roughest experiences and dead situations, we would be rejoicing then, remembering the truth, we will rise above them because our Savior lives. He walks with us, talks with us on our earthly journey. As we read and remember his word, the Bible, he clarifies it so we can understand his truths for our lives and live by them no matter what comes our way. He will reveal himself to us in the familiar breaking of bread in holy communion with him as we sup with him. He will join us behind closed doors in our prayer room. He will join us in the garden, in the quiet place, as we commune with him. He will allow us to touch and encounter him as the disciples did, so that we too know he is real. Our Jesus is truly alive, and he is alive forevermore. You ask me how I know he lives? Each one of us can come to that place where we can answer, He lives within my heart. And I have been transformed from death to abundant resurrected life through the resurrection power of my risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters, may we always remember, because it will make the biggest difference to our lives ever as we face life's rough situations on our road as we move to eternity with Him forever and ever. And so I just pray that we will all come to that place. We are so much in union and unity with Jesus and His promises and His words to us, that we experience His glorious resurrection power, giving us abundant life, even in the midst of all life's storms, because we are passing through. We can have this life until we are taken up into eternity to be with Him. May God bless you all. Amen.
Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the source of every mercy, the God of all consolation. Do not rely on yourselves alone, but put your trust in Him. For the God who can raise the dead to life again will also deliver you. And now, brothers and sisters, may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, equip you with all you need for doing His will. May He produce in you, through the power of Jesus Christ, all that is pleasing to Him. To Him be the glory, forever and ever. And the people of God say, Amen. Thank you for being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.